Welcome! This video will take the PowerBasic Console Compiler code we prepared in our last video and add some more advanced string handling and start to add some code libraries. And this is a program we used in our last video. A PowerBasic Console application used to read a text file and parse out the data contained within that file. Today we are going to look at creating libraries. Since your PowerBasic applications may well end up containing thousands of lines of code, it is easier when you get to that scale to actually break up your code base into different libraries. That way, when you're writing a program, you can just include a particular library that contains the functions or subroutines you wish to use in your new program, so that you can build up the program like Lego and effectively have code reuse. So what we're going to do today is we're going to create a library which we'll reference inside this application. All we need to do that is to put an include statement in and then the name of the library. Now, we haven't created a library yet, but what we're going to put into it is this function we had down here, the read the file function, we're going to put into a library. So I think we'll call this function file handling routines. So to create a new function, what we'll do is we'll create a new text file and we will call it, for description purposes, just what we call the file. And what we're going to do is we're going to take the code that's at the bottom here that reads the file and we're going to cut it out and we're going to paste it in to this new file. And we will save the file as this name. File, save as. And we save it with an INC extension just to illustrate the fact it's an include file. There we go. So we haven't actually changed any of the function of our program. We've just moved the functions around a wee bit. So we have the compile exit at the top to tell the program we want to create an executable. Dim all to say that we want all variables to dimension before use. We have an include file in here. And we have the two constants we created earlier. Now if we attempt to compile this, it's complaining. It's giving us an error message. Now, this is important because the reason it's giving error message, it stopped on this line here where we're setting the function equal to false. Now the reason for that, if we go back to our original program, at the time this was included, false had not yet been defined. Since PowerBasic works in a way it starts from the beginning of the program and then works all the way through, you have to define any functions or constants that are used later on before the program encounters them. So we'll move those two definitions further up the program. We'll compile again, and this time it's compiled quite happily without any errors at all. So if we run our program, it should do exactly what the program we did in the previous video. It should run, read the file, and output the text to the console. So we've created our first library. Now what you can do, if you hit the F2 button within the development environment, you get up a list of all the functions or subroutines or macros that are contained within this particular one. If you tick the little find all in files, it will display each of the files that we have on our screen in these two tabs. So it's telling you inside the PB. So it's telling us that of the functions actually listed, there are two. There's PB main and there's read the file. PB main is held in the hello world file, and the read the file function is contained in the include file pb file handling routines.inc. This way, if you have a program with many, many functions and subroutines, it's quite easy to find them. just by hitting the F2 button and then jumping straight to the file by double clicking on it. So what we're going to do now is we're going to do a bit more string handling. Now you'll remember from our last video we were reading a text file and parsing out the information contained in that file. We're going to do something a wee bit more elaborate this time. Here we have an Excel spreadsheet. We're not going to be directly from the Excel spreadsheet, that will come in a later video. What we're going to do is we have an Excel spreadsheet here with more columns, and also it has an address column, and the address column has commas in it. So we can't parse the data entirely using the comma. So what we're going to do here is we're going to do a file and a save as, and we're going to save the file as a tab delimited file. So there's a tab character between each column. So if we do that and we overwrite our myfile.txt, and we now have a new myfile.txt which has come in with a tab between each of the fields. So how do we handle this? Well, if we look back at our code is still going to be reading the same file. It's still going to want to test to see whether the file exists or not. But when it gets down to the point of actually opening the file, we read in the headers again, which will still work. We then pull the data lines in one by one. And you remember from the previous video, we pulled in the data using the parse command to slice up the string, using the comma as the delimiter. Now what we're using instead of a comma is a parse, is a tab. And PowerBasic contains a variable constant pre-built in called tab. If we replace each of the delimiter parameters with the tab, this should hopefully quite successfully read in the information we're after. So it should read the first delimited field, should bring in the second delimited field, and it should bring in the third delimited field. Now the third delimited field, as you'll see, has not only a comma in the middle, it has quotes at either end, so we'll handle them separately. And the fourth field, which is a telephone field, we're not actually handling. So what we're going to do, we're going to create a new variable. For telephone. Again as a string. And we'll put that one down there. And in this case, we're wanting to capture the fourth parameter. So just to prove we actually did capture the fourth parameter, we'll just build in a wee string at the end here. We'll tack that on to the end. So if we save that, go back to our main program and hit the compile button. And again, it's compiled successfully. So there haven't been any syntactical errors in any of the code we've done. Let's try running it. Oh, permission denied. Now remember, we created yesterday a error handler in the system to let us know if something else had access to the file. The reason we've got this error is that Excel still has the file open. So what we will do is we will finish our program, we will terminate the Excel program, and we will run again. And there we go, it's now worked successfully. It's pulled out the surname, the first name, and then the telephone. So now we're going to do some string manipulation on this file. At the moment we're getting the names out quite happily, but the telephone number in the data in the system has spaces in it. Say perhaps we want to actually remove the spaces programmatically, so we can store the telephone as one big long number. So what we're going to do in our routine where we pull up the telephone number. The telephone number is pulling it out as it exists in the file. So we want to update it. I'm going to use a command called remove. If in doubt, you can always hit the F1 to get the syntax of it. What the remove function actually does is it returns a copy of a string with characters or entire strings removed. So what we're doing in this case is we want to remove from the telephone variable basically a space character. So the easiest way to do that is that will remove any space characters it finds within the telephone one. So if we try running that now, it's correctly spotted. I have mistyped a variable name. There we go. The telephone number now has no spaces. So we performed a string handling function on the raw data that came out of the file. Now, the other bit of information you'll remember in the file is that the address, while it was in there, it had the comma in the middle, which was fine, but it had double quotes at either end. So what we want to do is we want to remove the double quotes. And as we did before, now, how do you put double quotes when double quotes themselves are in fact used to define strings? Well, there's another variable preset up in PowerBasic for you called $DQ, dollar double quote. And what this will do is it will look through that string, which is str address, and remove any double quotes it finds. So if we stick the address on the end, and we try running that now. There we go. We have the address at the end with no quotes on either end. Now the format doesn't look terribly helpful here. We can tidy it up. What we can do is we can put out the perhaps the forename and the surname together. Maybe put the address on our next line. And the telephone number on the last line. And since we want to break up the information, let's just put a blank line between each record. And try running this now. There we go. We're getting the person's first name, second name, their address, and the telephone number. So we perform some simple string manipulation on the data as existed in the file. And as you will see from the program, there is our hello world. It has now reached the dizzying heights of 28k in size. So it's still very small and it still runs very fast. One thing we're not doing is we don't know how big the file is. So what we can also do is we can also interrogate the file once it's been opened to find out how big the file is, how many lines of data are actually contained with it, using a command called filescan. Again, we can bring up the help on that, and we can see that if we give it the handle of the file, we can actually get it to output the number of records to one of our variables. So if we'll borrow the code that they've provided, and we will create a row notal variable to count how many rows. And we will define it up here. We'll make this a long variable because it's a number. And we know the file handle is this one. And having scanned the file, we can then output the number of records to the console so we can actually see. Now, normally sending things to the console, you're sending strings to the console. So we're going to add on to this piece of text, which we said number of records, the count. Now, if we did that, this will error because long count is a number, not a string. But we can convert the number to a string by the simple use of the format command. What this does is it turns any number into a string. And having done that, we can then run the program, go up to the top, and it says number of records 9. And there are indeed 9 records in the file. So, of course, if you were wanting to output some kind of feedback to the user, if there was a user actually watching this console program, you could say number of records 5,000, for example, if it's a big file, and then give some feedback every 100 records to the user to say that you've processed 100 records. And this way you give feedback to the user quite happily. So it's driven entirely by how many records there were to start with and how many records you've actually processed. Well, that completes today's video. Thank you for watching.